Okay, that's a smaller star. Then time would run even more slowly.
Vậy Recording in progress. Hello.
Hi. Hi.对，我们现在有个就是是学生是在线下集中的，
好，
所以我们在一个会议室里面。
OK， 我说话的声音你们听得到吧？
听得到。
OK。
所以你现在就在那个你们 center 的这个三楼还是二楼？
没有，这是个虚拟
啊，是个虚拟背景。OK。
我在家里，所以说如果有噪音的话就很不好意思，可能会有一点噪音。
但是这个图像是你们几楼的是吧？我记得。
哦，这个是对，是这个 PCTS， 就是 Princeton Center for Theoretical Science 的会议室。
好的，我们还有一点时间，还有五分钟，你九点开始吧。
OK。
就本来是想说，请你讲一下那个 bracket wormhole 的，你们 bracket wormhole 后面还有做吗？是继续做？
哦，你是听我讲那个 paper 吗？我还以为你是想让我讲那个 large D 的那个 paper， 我可能没仔细看那个 archive number。
OK。
哎呀，那这个就有点。这个跨的有点大，呵呵，不好意思。OK， 对，对，最近没有在想那方面的东西，最近都在做这个和这个 stringy black hole 相关的东西。
那行
。那这个
啊，没问题，有一点关系嘛，是不是？至少从从 string 的角度还是有点关系的。
都是跟 black hole 有关。
对。
错了，要不然让我试一下 share slides。你要允许我那个？
哦，你授权一下，你说可以授权一下，点它就可以。
点它。
它有个后面的点。允许什么什么？没有允许共享屏幕吗？
那么我就设他主持人
了。那就他有权限，静音什么的，对他不行。
可能是我这个账号还是级别不够。
你不是主持人吗？你应该就点我名字边，他有一个设为主持人之类的。设为
啊，对，是的。
嗯，现在可以了吗？
现在应该可以，我试一下。OK。看得到吗？
可以看到。
OK， 我等一下再试。 我一会儿的报告可以用英文讲吗？
可以，可以。
OK，
可以，没问题。英文讲还是习惯一点。
对，都是用英文讲的。
你们那边现在就是已经都正常了，是吧？这个
对，
学术活动啊，
都是正常的。
会要求室内戴口罩吗？
戴口罩是需要的。除此之外就没有什么区别。
就是 domestic traveling 呢，就是国内那边旅游 travel 也没问题。
没问题，我其实明天早上就要去 California。
哎哇，那还是 OK， 那还有点远呢，很远。
对，我要去 Caltech 也是讲这个报告。
会不会有人以为的要你尿？然后发现没人，有可能。你那个海报好吗？我们稍微等一分钟。好，那我们开始吧。我们今天非常高兴的邀请到了普林斯顿的陈一鸣，给我们讲这个 Stream Black Hole Transition 的报告。一鸣是之前是毕业于清华，对吧？应该是姚红老师组的吗？如果我记得没错的话，
他是翟慧老师组的。
翟慧老师 ，OK， 搞错了 ，OK， 好，对，现在是几年级？
现在是四年级。
现在是在普林斯顿研究生四年级，他的 advisor 是 Montesina， 最近有非常有意思的工作。好，我们现在有请陈一鸣。
好的，我 share 一下 screen。Okay, so I'll just use English to give the talk. Thanks very much for inviting me to talk today. And I will be discussing this recent paper that I wrote with Juan Madacena and Edward Wheaton which is about some aspects of the black hole stream transition. So just to set up the stage, I will be considering black holes in string theory, and particularly in string theory in this background. Basically, I will be considering capital D dimensional flat spacetime product with some internal space, which will be left implicit throughout the talk. So I will use little d to denote the spatial dimensions. And we will be looking at the structural black hole in this flat space time. We will be either considering the Lorentzian problem or the Euclidean problem. In the Euclidean problem, the time direction will be Euclidean and it will be compactified on the circle. So it has long been speculated that if we consider a structural black hole in string theory, when we slowly decrease the size of the black hole, it will actually turn into a highly excited string when the size of the black hole is of the order the size of the string. Why do we expect this?
Okay. 因为现在你是主持人权限，你直接把静音就可以了。
我自己来是吧？
对。
OK， 我试一下。应该可以吧 ？OK， let me just continue. So, so how do we really see that? So one idea is to look at the relation between the entropy and the mass for either a black hole or a string.So let me remind you that if we look at the entropy for a black hole in Einstein gravity, the entropy scales as the structural radius to the d minus 2 power. So this is the famous area formula for the entropy of a black hole. While just by dimensional analysis, you see that the mass has one less power. So it tells you that the entropy basically is proportional to the structural radius times its mass.And therefore, if you plot the entropy as a function of mass in this plane, you see that it is a curve that is bending upwards. Basically, the slope, which is the structural radius, grows together with the mass. On the other hand, if you look at the entropy mass relation of a free string, just by counting the states of an oscillating string, a simple calculation in perturbative string theory will tell you that the entropy is simply linear in the mass.So it's proportional to the mass with a coefficient, which is a fixed number, which I denote by beta h here. I will talk more about this number later. But for now, we just need to know that beta h is a number that is of order the string length with a prefactor that is an order one number. Therefore, if we plot the entropy mass curve for a free string, we see that it's just a straight curve.And it crosses the curve for a black hole at some point. Now we can ask at this point, how large is the black hole? And the thing you see from these two equations is that at that point, the structural radius of the black hole is essentially of the string scale. Therefore the size of the black hole is basically the size of string length.Therefore, you might expect, okay, at this point, the black hole has the same entropy, same mass, and the same size as a string. So maybe it just turns into a free string. But this picture is not correct. The reason is that, one reason is that if you really look at the size of the string at this mass, the size of the string is very large. It's much larger than the size of the black hole. Essentially, the reason is that in string theory, when youstart to oscillate a string, the expectation value of the length of the string gets longer and longer. It grows with the number of oscillations. And it grows in a way that is proportional to the square root of the entropy. And since we are working in the, so throughout this talk, I will be working in the limit where the string coupling is very small. In other words, the Newton's constant is very small. Therefore, the entropy of the black hole will be very large.And as well as the entropy of the string at this point. So square root of S is some very large number. And this, the size of the string is much larger than the size of the black hole. So therefore this picture, this naive argument of the string black hole transition is not correct. I will be talking about an improvement to this picture. But before I go there, let me just make some comments on this number beta h. So this number beta h is called the inverse Hagedorn temperature, and it is proportional to the string length with a coefficient which is order one number.
Sorry, can I ask the previous slide?
Yes,
please. So inside the square root s, there is another square root ls, right?
You mean the inside the square root is just s, it's just the entropy.
Yeah, but s is proportional to ls, because beta h is proportional to ls.
So s is a dimensionless number, so the entropy is just a number, and it's essentially the log of the number of excitation modes at this energy. But you're right, yes, square root of s is proportional. If you take this formula, it is proportional to beta h.
Okay.
The product, I mean, the product beta h times the mass is some dimensionless number. So s is just some huge number. It is just the log of the number of states. Okay.
So, so do you allow string go into the internal space?
Go into what?
Internal space. You said that there is
No. So here we are just considering the string propagating in the capital D dimension. Nothing will be about the internal space in this talk.
Okay,
so the beta H is just called the inverse Hagedorn temperature. And the reason that it is important in string theory is that if you look at the density of states for a single oscillating string, that you consider a single string which is oscillating, the density of state grows with the energy exponentially. So it goes like e to this number times the energy. Therefore, if we trace, if we look at the canonical partition function for a single oscillating mode, you see that it is only well-defined if the inverse temperature is greater than the inverse Hagedorn temperature, or in more physical words, is when the temperature is lower than the Hagedorn temperature, then this partition function is well-defined. This is why people usually say that in string theory, there is this maximum temperature, which is called the Hagedorn temperature. So a nice perspective that will be very useful in the following is that just as in usual quantum field theory, when we consider finite temperature physics, we consider the theory not in Lorentzian space-time, but in a Euclidean space-time, where the time is compactified on the circle whose length is the inverse temperature. So in string theory, we can do the same thing, and we consider string theory on a Euclidean space, where time is an S1 with length beta, and the spatial part is the little d dimensional space. So here I schematically draw that as a cylinder. Well, this circle dimension direction is the time, while the transverse direction is the little d dimensional space. But unlike usual quantum field theory, a special property of string theory is that whenever you have a circle, the string has a possibility of winding around that circle. So you can have a string which winds around that circle once, twice, or multiple times, but the particular string mode that we will be interested in is the mode that winds around the circle once. The reason is that that mode has the smallest mass, and its mass goes like beta squared minus beta Hagedorn squared. Strictly speaking, this formula is only true in the bosonic string theory and the type two string theory. In the heterotic string theory, which is a string theory that is asymmetric between the left and right moving sector, the formula is slightly more complicated because the winding mode also has a momentum along the time direction, but that is a higher order detail that I won't go into in this talk. The essential point is that you see from this mass formula, the mass becomes zero when the temperature gets very close to the Hagedorn temperature. That is an important fact that will be useful later. So how do we describe this mode? We can describe it using an effective theory in the little d dimensions. So you can imagine compactify, do a reduction on this circle and consider effective theory in the spatial dimensions. And this particular winding mode is described by a complex scalar field with the following mass. The reason that it's a complex scalar field is because the string can wind in either directions. It can wind in this direction or the other direction. So you can write down this effective action, and the most crucial thing, as I already mentioned, is that the mass term becomes zero when we approach the Hagedorn temperature. So let me return to the question that we have seen earlier, that at the point where the black hole, the size of the black hole is of the size of a fundamental string, we see that the physical size of the string is actually much larger than the size of the black hole. But in that analysis, something important is ignored. That is the gravitational attraction between the different parts of the highly excited string. Therefore, one might hope that after you take into account the gravitational attraction between different parts of the string actually shrinks, its size gets smaller, and at that mass, the actual physical size of the string is of the order as the size of the black hole. But how do we actually account for that? How do we actually study this problem with gravitational attraction? So a very nice way to describe it is discussed in this beautiful paper by Horowitz and Pochinski in 97. That is, they consider effective theory when we are very close to the Hagedorn temperature, but still below the Hagedorn temperature. So in terms of the parameter that I was mentioning, this corresponds to the parameter regime where beta minus beta h is much smaller than the string length, okay? So we want to consider this effective theory, and whenever we are considering effective action, we want to focus on those modes that are lightest. So we can just look at the long wavelength physics. So what are the lightest fields in this effective theory? As usual, in string theory, we always have a bunch of massless fields, which include gravity, Dilaton, and the B field in the NS-NS sector. So the B field will actually not be excited in this solution. So I will leave it implicit in the following discussion. But the gravity and Dilaton will be important. And as I already mentioned, there is also a nearly massless field chi, which is the winding mode. So we can write down this action. So this action is an action in the little d dimension space and includes the Einstein-Hilbert term, includes the Dilaton term, the kinetic term for the Dilaton. It also includes the chi field and its mass term, okay? But there is an extra mode, which is this phi mode, which I didn't mention earlier. So what is this phi field? We can call this phi field as the radian. So the reason that it arises is because we did a dimensional reduction on the Euclidean circle, and the size of the Euclidean circle can fluctuate in the space-time. Essentially, the idea is that we fix the size of the Euclidean circle at infinity to be beta, while inside the space-time, the size of the circle can fluctuate, and we parameterize that as beta times e to the phi. So phi is a field which depends on the spatial directions. And after we do the dimensional reduction, we get this kinetic term for the phi field. It's also a massless field in the little d dimension. So we got this action, and we want to look for a localized condensate solution in this effective action, which can describe this bound state of a highly excited string. So at first sight, this action looks very complicated. How do we actually find the solution? So a very nice simplification that was pointed out by Horowitz and Pochinski is that if we now look at how the chi field, how the chi field is coupled to other degrees of freedom, we see that, for example, if you look at how chi is coupled to the little d dimensional metric and the Dilaton, you see that the coupling is proportional to mass square. So an important thing that I told you earlier is that the mass square is very, very small when we are close to the Hagedorn temperature. On the other hand, we can expand the mass square as a series expansion in phi. So the leading term is simply the mass square at infinity, which is, as I said, is beta square minus beta h square, and it's very small. while the linear term has an order one coefficient. So this is this kappa divided by alpha prime is just some order one number that depends on, it's an order one number which depends on which string theory you are looking at. But what's important is that this number is not small. So the coupling between the chi-square and phi is large compared to coupling to other all the other fields. So therefore, to the leading order in this problem, we can just focus on the coupling between chi-square and phi. The idea is that we organize everything in a perturbative series in this small number that is beta minus beta h divided by L3. So to the leading order, we just get the following two equations. The first equation is an equation of motion for chi field, and it describes how the chi moves in a non-trivial potential corresponding to this phi field. On the other hand, so you also have another equation, which the second equation is just the Einstein equation. It describes how the phi field is back reacted by a non-trivial source corresponding to this chi field. So you got these two equations, and they are nonlinear equations, but you can solve them numerically. And in fact, for the case where the capital D dimension is four, that is corresponds to our spacetime, our dimension, these equations have been studied in the literature for in some other context. People have studied them when they are thinking about gravitating Bose-Einstein condensate, and they've solved essentially the same equations. And we can just take their solution and apply it here. Is there a question? Okay, so the conclusion that you draw from this analysis by analyzing these two equations that spherical symmetry and normalizable solutions, they can only be found when the capital D is equal to 4, 5, and 6. When the capital D dimension is greater than 6, what happens is that you cannot find normalizable solutions anymore. Intuitively, the picture would be that in higher dimensions, the gravitational attraction, the Newtonian potential decays very fast at long distances. So the gravitational attraction is never strong enough to pull the different parts of the string together and form a bound state. When capital D is smaller than 4, that is in lower dimensions scenarios, one simply cannot trust these equations, because to trust these equations, we are doing a power series expansion in phi. But you see, in lower dimensions, if you solve this Poisson equation for phi, you find that the phi has a very large back reaction, and you simply cannot trust this analysis. But let me just focus on the D equals to 4 case, which is the most interesting case. In this case, you see that the solution takes the following form. So the chi field, the winding mode, essentially decays exponentially as a function of the radial direction, while the phi field decays as a power law because it's essentially proportional to the Newtonian potential. So in four dimension, it decays as one over rho, as one over the radial direction. And the most important feature of the solution is that you see that the phi is negative. So the circle gets smaller inside the spacetime, like close to the center of the solution. It gets smaller, but it's never vanishing. Like it still has a finite size even at the origin. So one should contrast this with the behavior of a Euclidean black hole. For the Euclidean black hole, the Euclidean circle shrinks to a point at the horizon. So the behavior of the geometry is quite different. So what we find, what Horowitz and Pochinski, they find is a star solution of strings. And in the following, I will just refer to it as the Horowitz-Pochinski solution. But even though I said it's a star solution, but it's clearly a solution that has been constructed in Euclidean signature. It's because that only in the Euclidean signature, where time is compactified on the circle, the winding mode can be well-defined. We don't know how to understand the meaning of the winding mode in the Lorentzian signature. So strictly speaking, we have a Euclidean solution. However, we will see that many of the properties of this Euclidean solution also have nice interpretation in the Lorentzian signature. As I will argue, it essentially describes gravitationally bound state of a string, which is essentially a string star. So what are the properties in the Lorentzian signature? The first property, which is closely related to the story I was mentioning earlier, is the size of the solution. So to understand the size of the solution in the Lorentzian signature, we can simply analytically continue the metric and the stress tensor that you get from this Euclidean solution into Lorentzian signature and look at how the metric is back reacted, how it's deformed. And that gives you a sense of the size of the string star. So what you find is that unlike free string, which is the green curve here, unlike free string, well, the size grows as the square root of its mass or its entropy. The Horowitz-Pochinsky solution has a different behavior where its mass decreases as a function of its size decreases as a function of mass. So you see at some point, gravitational attraction becomes strong, which is denoted by this orange blob here. And since it becomes strong, it starts to pull the string together. And when you further increase the mass, the star actually becomes denser and denser and becomes smaller. And if you extrapolate this curve, you see that at the point where you naively think that the black hole will be of the size of a fundamental string, you see that the Horowitz-Pochinsky solution also shrinks to the size of a fundamental string. Of course, I should stress that the Horowitz-Pochinsky solution is only can be only trusted at this point. So at the point where the size is very large compared to the string size. The reason is that we can only trust the effective theory if the derivatives of the fields are very small compared to the string scale. But you can naively extrapolate that equation and that gives you a match to the black hole answer. So.
Can I ask a question here?
Yes.
So about the figure, so is there a regime where I can see string as a probe, but the string can probe a black hole, something like.
The string
in Lorenzo, the string somehow cross the horizon, like that.
So you mean you want to, I didn't hear very clearly, but you mean you want to see a solution where you have both black hole and string?
Or? That's right.
Yeah. So let me stress that in this Horowitz-Pochinsky solution, there is no black hole. There is just this star solution. But it's true that if you have a black hole in string theory, and when the black hole gets smaller and smaller, there will be a string Edmonds field that is close to the horizon of the black hole. But the topology of the solution will still be the topology of a Euclidean black hole where the circle shrinks to a point. So topologically, it is distinct from this Horowitz-Pochinsky solution.
I see. I saw a page where you can keep both black hole and the string, and there might be a way to see the entropy correction, like the contribution, entropy contribution from strings to the existing black hole.
Yeah, definitely. When the black hole gets smaller, the stringy atmosphere will make a larger and larger contribution to the entropy compared to the entropy of just the black hole. So that's right. There will be corrections of the kind you are talking about, but that will not be the focus of the talk today. The talk today will be not about the stringy atmosphere that is outside the black hole. It will just be a string star solution and there's no black hole. Does that make sense?
Okay, thank you.
Okay. But later I will be talking about how this string star solution is connected to the black hole. So the analog in real life is like how the neutron star, how the supernova is connected to the black hole, stuff like that. Okay. So let me talk a little bit about another thing, another property you can think about the solution is the thermodynamics of the solution. So for Euclidean solution, one famous way to extract the thermodynamics is the so-called Gibbons-Hawking procedure. So which is a method that is usually applied to Euclidean black holes. And that basically gives you the, you can use that to derive the entropy formula for a black hole. But the idea is that we can also use that the same philosophy to compute the thermodynamics of a string star. So you have this Euclidean solution, you can compute its action. I've written down its action earlier. You can just evaluate it and take the derivative with respect to beta, et cetera, and that gives you the entropy. So you can apply this procedure and you find that the entropy is given by a fairly simple formula. It's an order one number, which is not important. It's proportional to the inverse Hagedorn temperature. It's also proportional to one over the Newton's constant. So it's a classical entropy. It's a very large entropy. And it's also proportional to the integral of chi squared over space, okay? So if you look at this formula, if you analyze it, you see that the entropy is essentially beta Hagedorn times the mass of the object plus some higher order corrections. So here, when I say higher order, I specifically mean higher order in the expansion of beta minus beta H, okay? The expansion that I was mentioning earlier. So if you just look at the leading term, you see that the formula has the same form as the entropy for a free string when we neglect all the gravitational attraction. So it matches the entropy of a highly excited string gas or lone string with some corrections. So the reason that you expect some correction is because, so here the string is confined into some smaller volume. So intuitively you think that the string has less degrees, has less freedom to oscillate because it's confined in the volume. On the other hand, the temperature in the center of the solution is higher. So naively, you also think that that might bring the entropy larger. So there are these all these kind of corrections, potential corrections to the entropy. And we discussed some of the corrections in our paper. But what's important is for now is the leading term. And that matches the entropy of a highly excited string gas. So this tells you that we have a clear Lorentzian interpretation of the entropy, which is just counting all the oscillating modes of a highly excited string gas. So let me remind you that Euclidean methods have been very successful in computing entropies in quantum gravity. A recent very nice progress in physics is in theoretical physics is that people have applied this kind of Euclidean methods and successfully reproduced the page curve, at least in some toy models. But what's special about this Horowitz-Pochinsky solution is that it is a nice example that we can compute the entropy using this kind of Euclidean methods while we also know the order the microstates in the Lorentzian signature, just as the oscillating states of a highly excited string, at least conceptually, if we neglect all the corrections. Of course, quantitatively, you will get, quantitatively, there are these corrections which are due to the effects that I was mentioning. But conceptually, we have an understanding of the microstates. On the other hand, we don't really have such a understanding for a black hole. That's why this is the main reason that you might want to, one might be interested in learning more about this Horowitz-Pochinsky solution and see whether that can shed any light on understanding the microstates of a black hole. Let me, the last property that I want to mention is that it's about this orange block, which is supposed to be a place where the gravitational attraction between different parts of a string gas becomes strong and starts to pull different parts together and form a star solution, okay? So we can understand this orange blob from two sides. So we can understand it from the free string side, and we can estimate when we will expect a bound state to form by doing a very simple calculation. It's essentially a back of envelope calculation. Basically, you look at the Schrodinger equation for a small string excitation with mass that is order one over string length in a gravitational potential generated by this string gas. So you can study this Schrodinger equation and ask when a bound state will you will expect to fall. And doing this easy calculation, you see that you expect the bound state to form when the mass is of order 1 over the string coupling to some positive power. So the specific power depends on the dimension that you are looking at. And that's how you understand this transition from the free string side. You can also understand it from the Horowitz-Pochinsky side. So the Horowitz-Pochinsky solution is some classical solution that is a, you basically get it by solving the classical equation of motions. But you can only trust the classical solution if the quantum fluctuations around the classical solution are controlled. In other words, only when the stringy corrections, like corrections involving the string coupling, are small. So you can estimate when those quantum fluctuations will become strong, and you get the same answer essentially. When the mass is of order this number, the quantum fluctuations become strong. So from these two perspectives, we have a rough picture of what's going on in this orange block. It's simply a free string that is the gravitational attraction becomes strong and gradually pulls different parts together and form a smaller and smaller object. But the next part of the talk will be about the purple blob, which is a regime where you expect a transition between the Horowitz-Pochinsky solution and the black hole solution. And we will be discussing the nature of this transition, at least what we can say about that. So are there any questions at this point? Okay. If there are no more questions, then I'll just continue. So before I discuss how these two solutions, the black hole solution and Horowitz-Pochinsky solutions, are connected, let me make a few comments about some comparison between the two solutions. So both the Horowitz-Pochinsky solution and the black hole solutions, they are classical solutions. So there are questions? Okay, now then I continue. Let me just mute.
Yeah, I think you should mute Max.
Yeah, if you have questions, just maybe raise a hand or something, but you can just also interrupt me, but let me just continue for now. And so both of them are classical solutions in string theory, and a fundamental statement in string theory is that classical solutions correspond to Walsh's CFTs. So there are both of the solutions should be described by certain Walsh's CFTs. And the question then becomes how the two Walsh's CFTs are related when we tune the parameter, which is the parameter that is the temperature. So let me remind you that the validity of the two solutions are the following. The black hole solution is valid when the temperature is low, or in other words, when the inverse temperature is very large. Therefore, the curvature of the black hole solution is very small. On the other hand, the Horowitz-Pochinsky solution is valid when the difference between when the temperature is very high, very close to the hexagonal temperature. Okay, so they are valid, strictly speaking, they are valid in different regimes, but we are interested in how the extrapolation between of the two solutions are related in the middle, in the regime where we don't have analytic control currently. So both of the classical solutions, they break the winding symmetry. So the point that the Horowitz-Pochinsky solution breaks the winding symmetry is very simple. It's simply because the winding mode has a VAF on the background. And the point that the black hole breaks the winding symmetry is also easy to see. As I said earlier, the characteristic property of a black hole solution is that the Euclidean circle shrinks to a point. But therefore, you can just, if you put a winding string on this background, the winding string can simply go to the tip of the solution and become unwound. Therefore, the winding number is not conserved on this background. So since the same winding symmetry is broken on both sides, you cannot just feed these two solutions into the usual lambda paradigm of phase transition, because it's not that a certain symmetry is broken only on one side. This might be the first reason that you might expect a smooth transition between the two, okay? And let me also mention, it's related to the question earlier, that because the winding number is not conserved on the Euclidean black hole background, you can also argue that there is also a VAF of the winding mode, although it's small, but it's also non-zero outside the horizon. And that describes also some excited stream on the atmosphere outside the horizon. So both the solutions have entropy at the classical level, which means that they have an entropy that is proportional to one over the Newton's constant. The black hole has a horizon as well as an interior in the Lorentzian space-time, while the Horwitz-Potrinsky solution does not have those things. So the question that we want to ask is, are these two CFTs, these two Walshi CFTs, smoothly connected or not as you tune the parameter beta? This is just a physical question that one usually asks. Let me stress it. This is a physical question that one usually asks in condensed matter physics, that you have some model and you tune the parameter and ask whether there's a phase transition between the two. So this solution has nothing very mysterious about it. But what's difficult about this question is that we don't have a concrete construction of the two solutions in the purple blob that I showed earlier in the middle regime. So this is the reason why it's more difficult than the usual condensed matter physics problems, where you at least know the Hamiltonian, know the form of the Hamiltonian explicitly. But here we don't have that, that knowledge. So we need something else to address this question, whether they can be smoothly connected or not. Let me just first tell you the conclusion and I will give you some argument. So in short, we found different behavior in different string theories. In the type two string theory, we find argument that says that they cannot be smoothly connected as Walshi CFTs. There must be some singular point in the middle. On the other hand, in the heterotic string theory, from our analysis, seems they are likely smoothly connected, and we haven't found any obstruction to the possibility of having a smooth transition between the two, okay? So we did not really consider the bosonic string case, since the bosonic string already has a tachyon, which is not the winding mode. So it is not obvious that the discussion even makes sense in the bosonic string theory. So let me give you some idea about how we try to address this question. So the key idea is that for supersymmetric sigma models that is supposed to describe the Walshi CFTs in the type two or and the heterotic case, we can look at supersymmetric invariants that cannot vary smoothly when you tune certain parameters in the theory. So I think, as you might have heard of, the most famous invariance in supersymmetric theories is the so-called Witten index, which was proposed by Edward Witten in his very beautiful paper in the 87 about constraints on supersymmetry breaking. And the Witten index is defined as a trace of the minus one to the F, where F is the Walshi fermion number, times some converging factor. So this factor e to the minus beta h is just a converging factor, which is introduced to make the sum conversion. Let me just stress that this beta has nothing to do with the beta I was talking about. This is different. This is just an arbitrary number. And as Witten showed in his 87 paper, if we consider nonlinear sigma models with 1, 1 Walshi supersymmetry, that is you have both the left moving and the right moving supersymmetry, that is, this will be appropriate for the type two case, the Witten index of a nonlinear sigma model is equal to the Euler characteristic of the target space, which means that we can simply look at the topology of the Horwitz-Potrinsky solution and the black hole solution, and then decide whether the Euler characteristic are the same or not. But of course, the first thing you might complain is that both the Horowitz potential solution and the black hole solution, they are non-compact solutions. They extend to infinity as you increase the radial direction. But the physical argument is that the two solutions, one argument is that the two solutions look exactly the same far away. So what's really important is the geometry near the center. And you can compactify the two solutions in different ways near infinity. And essentially you just compactify the two solutions in the same way, and then the Euler characteristic become well-defined and is determined by the geometry near the center. There are also some other arguments which makes it clearer that it really doesn't depend on what's going on far away, but I won't go into the detail of those arguments for now. Let me just tell you the conclusion. The conclusion is that from this analysis, you see that when the capital D is even, that is for all cases, when capital D is 4 or 6, the index between the two is 2 rather than 0, it's non-zero. So there must be some singular point in the way when we tune the temperature parameter so that the index suddenly changes, okay? For when the dimension is odd, you need to change the index are actually the same, and you need to change the calculation a little bit. And just a small twist of the calculation will suggest the same conclusion that there is a singular point in the way. On the opposite, if we now look at sigma models with 0, 1 Wallace supersymmetry, which is appropriate for the heterotic case, let me remind you that the heterotic string theory is only is a string theory which only has supersymmetry in its right moving sector, but not the left moving sector. So in that case, the index, the Witten index, is not equal to the Euler characteristic, that it is equal to the index of the Dirac operator in the Torquay space. So the Dirac operator, which is essentially a derivative operator, it is odd under a parity transformation, which sends x to minus x. And since both the Horowitz-Poschinsky solution and the black hole solution, they are symmetric under parity transformation, the index of the Dirac operator vanishes in both cases. And more generally, there are no known obstructions in the heterotic case that can distinguish the two solutions, the Horowitz-Poschinsky solution and the black hole solution. Therefore, by looking at this invariance, we basically end up at a conclusion that in type 2 case, there is a clear.
I'm sorry, does this mean in the type 2 case, if you only count in left and right, then you also get this matching result?
Yeah, that's right. Yes. So.
But you don't think that's the evidence for smooth?
No, but. To argue that it is not smooth, you only need to find one invariant that is not continuous.
Okay.
You can have a lot of invariants. Some of them might be smooth, but to argue that something happened in the middle, you only need to find one that is not smooth. And it suffices to find this Witten index. What's different in the heterotic case is that for the 0, 1 Wallace supersymmetry model, all the known invariants in the literature, they are cobordism invariants. Meaning that if two space-time, they are cobordant to each other, there are no invariants that we know can distinguish the two. And one can show, as we're discussing the paper, one can show that the Horowitz-Poschinsky solution and the black hole solution, they are cobordant to each other. So there are no known invariants in the literature that can distinguish the two in the heterotic case.
Mm-hmm.
Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So it's not so satisfying to just have an index argument, of course. Ideally, we want to just know how the transition actually works in the CFT, but that is a question that is so very difficult and we don't know how to address that at this point. But we can, to get more insight, it is useful to consider an offshore problem. So let me tell you what offshore means. So, when we usually think about a CFT, we can think of it as some IR limit of some UV non-conformal theories. And one way to think about it is to think of it as some IR limit of linear sigma models. So let's think about some linear sigma models which involve some parameters. And the idea is that when the parameter is in one regime, the ground state manifold of the linear sigma model has the topology of the Horowitz-Pochinsky solution. And when we tune the parameter, in the UV, you see explicitly that the topology changes and the ground state manifold becomes the topology of a black hole solution. So the ground state manifolds, they are supposed to be described by some nonlinear sigma model when you integrate out all the massive direct, the massive excitations. And the hope is that under the RG, the corresponding nonlinear sigma models, which have the right topology, actually flows through the right CFT that we want to study. That is the Horowitz-Pochinsky solution and the black hole. Let me emphasize that this idea is not wishful thinking. It's not wishful thinking to think that this will flow to the CFT. After all, first of all, usually under RG, theories flow to CFTs. And the structural black hole solution, for example, is the unique solution of the Einstein equation, plus corrections, of course, with the right topologies and symmetries. So if you start with something that has the topology of a black hole, you expect to land on the actual black hole solution. And in fact, in the literature, people have done this RG flow fairly explicitly for the Euclidean black hole solution. Here, we are just saying that we can apply the same idea for the Horowitz-Pochinsky solution. On the other hand, the subtlety is that both the Horowitz-Pochinsky solution and the black hole solution, they have a common negative mode, which essentially corresponding to changing the size of the solution. And so if you have a negative mode in the CFT, it corresponds to a relevant operator under the RG. So you expect that in the UV, it's likely that you need to fine tune some parameter. Otherwise, under RG flow, it will either flow to an infinite large black hole solution or infinitely small black hole solution, which is just an empty flat space. So it's just saying, this is just saying that in the UV, you expect to have more parameters than just a single parameter, which is beta, which is the temperature, so that you can adjust some of them to ready flow to the solution that you're interested in. Okay, so let me just go through the particular example fairly quickly. That is a simple construction in the 1,1 supersymmetric linear sigma model, which is specific, which is designed for the type 2 case. And in that case, we will be considering the following superpotential. So in this superpotential W, P, X, and Y, they are superfields. So I'm abusing the notation a little bit because in the first line here, P, X, Y are superfields. So they contain bosonic part, fermionic part, and like auxiliary part. But in the later in the equations, I'm just using X, Y, P to denote the scalar part. And hopefully it won't be confusing. But the detail is not so important. What's important is that you have a X, which is a two component field that parameterizes the circle direction, the time direction. And you have a Y, which is a little d dimensional field. It parameterizes the sphere direction. And if you write down this potential, this superpotential, you see that the supersymmetric ground states, they satisfy the following equations at tree level. So at tree level, you have the first equation, which is essentially taking derivative with respect to P. And you also have another equation, which is taking derivative with respect to Y, X. And if you look at these equations for a while, you'll see that when C minus AB is greater than zero, the first equation implies a topology. That is the topology of the black hole. Essentially, the circle shrinks to a point while the the transverse sphere still has a finite size. And in this ground state, the expectation value of the P field, the scalar component of the field, is just zero, okay? On the other hand, when you are on the other side, when you tune parameters so that C minus AB is now negative, you see that the topology implied by this equation actually changes. It changes to the topology of a Horowitz-Pochinsky solution, well, the time circle doesn't shrink to a point while the transverse direction shrink to a point at the origin. Again, in this solution, the expectation value of P is just zero. So in this model, you can see explicitly what happens in the middle. Something weird happens. So what's weird is that at C minus AB, when it is zero, that is at the transition point, there's a new direction that opens up in the ground state manifold. Classically, it's a direction which is when X and Y are both zero and P is non-zero, but it can be an arbitrary number. So geometrically, you can think of this new direction as an infinite line parameterized by the value of P. However, this analysis is not very complete because here we're just looking at the essentially the tree level superpotential. But in general, we should also look at quantum corrections to the potential. And a more detailed analysis, basically taking into account certain loop diagrams, it tells you that you generate the superpotential for the P field, and that changes the picture a little bit. Instead of having an infinite line when at the transition point, you find that when C minus AB is less than zero, you have some isolated vacua, which is vacua when X and Y are both zero, but P is given by some fixed value, a function of A, B, and C. So just to give you a picture, when C minus AB is greater than zero, if we look at the ground state of this linear sigma model, it's a connected manifold that has the topology of the black hole. And you have a lot of massless directions to move on this ground state manifold. And that manifold, we expect it to flow to the black hole solution. On the other hand, when C minus AB is negative, the ground state manifold branches into several parts. So one large part is has the topology of the Horowitz-Poczynski solution, and we expect that flows to the actual Horowitz-Poczynski solution, but it has also some isolated massive vacua, which are just some isolated ground states, and there are no massless directions that you can move around this vacuum, okay? So all the excitations are massive around that. Therefore, these two dots, they are not described by certain CFTs. So these two dots, they compensate for the difference in the index that we found earlier for the CFT. Basically, they contribute a 2 to the Witten index, and that makes the Witten index in the linear sigma model match. But you see that if you just focus on the CFTs, you see that the index doesn't match. The reason is that some you can interpret that as some part of the black hole branches off, like separate, it gets separated from the continuum and becomes this massive vacuum. Let me make some comments on this.
Sorry, can I ask this picture, previous slides? Do you think HP solution is the UV? Which one is UV, which one is I think if they're supposedly RT?
So, This linear sigma model is some UV model. And so this linear sigma model has some ground state, okay? And it also has some massive excitations. So you can think of the RG in two steps. The first step is that I integrate out all the massive excitations, and what's left is the ground state. So the Horowitz-Poczynski's types ground state is the ground state manifold that has the topology of a Horowitz-Poczynski solution. But that ground state manifold is not a CFT because you need to do a further RG flow to flow to the IR limit on your worksheet to really flow to a conformal field theory. Does that make sense? Basically, this ground state is described by a nonlinear sigma model, and the RG flow of a nonlinear sigma model is just the described by the Ricci flow equation, right?
So when you're counting this index, you take into account these two vacua, two masses.
Yeah. So you can count it in the linear sigma model, and then you should count these two vacua, and the index match on the two sides of the linear sigma model, which makes sense. But the point is that if you only focus on the CFT, which is described by all the massless excitations, you don't see the vacua anymore because they are separated from the continuum by some potential barrier. And therefore you found a jump in the return index. If you just focus on these two continuum ground states.
Yeah, just make sure I understand correctly. So your point is you first you take no energy limit, you go to some no energy of this HP, then you further flow to the black hole. And that's the, what is there a flow to collect the HP in the black hole?
No. Well, let me just focus on this side. The idea is that you focus on the ground state of this linear sigma model. It has the topology of a black hole. So if you write down the metric of this ground state, it has the topology of the black hole, but it's not a structural black hole solution. You need to further do an RG flow so that this actually flows to the black hole solution. And this has been done in the literature. Like you write down a metric that is has the topology of a black hole, but not exactly, it's not exactly the black hole. And then you do the so-called receive flow, which is the RG flow for a nonlinear sigma model. And you see that it actually flows to the structural black hole solution. Does that make sense?
Yeah, that's fine. I thought that there, you want to argue there is some RG connecting this HP and the black hole.
No.
Okay. No. So you talk about it separately.
There are so these two pictures are two different regimes in parameter space. So in the linear sigma model, you tune some parameter and you go from one picture to the other. And the point is that it's hard to understand the transition between the two CFTs directly. So you might want to first have some UV model which you can understand the transition just explicitly. And then you can study how that information gets changed under the RG flow. So we didn't really do the full analysis of the RG flow, the second step, like how the transition changes in the RG flow. But that is an interesting question that one might be able to study further.
Okay.
So let me make some comments on this construction. So this specific construction that I just talked about, it doesn't really behave too well under the RG. So here, when I say it doesn't behave well, I mean the RG from the linear sigma model to the ground state manifold, not the second step, not the RG of the nonlinear sigma model. Basically, what you find is that after you integrate out all these massive excitations, you see that the size of the circle, for example, for the black hole, it doesn't approach the constant at infinity. It has a logarithmic grow. It grows slowly as a function of the radial direction. But this is just an artifact of this specific model that we are looking at. One can change the model a little bit and you can address this problem. And we have proposed improvement of the model, and it has been updated in version 2 of the paper. So after you take that into account, the circle simply goes to a constant and infinity. So the massive vacua that we found from this linear sigma model construction, a priori has nothing to do with string theory, because the linear sigma model doesn't have anything to do with string theory, because string theory is some statement about just the CFTs. But it's tantalizing to understand, to think about whether you might identify this massive vacua as some objects in string theory, such as the deep rings. Because one thing I didn't have time to mention is that there are some deep rings that exist only on one side, like on the black hole side, and not on the Horowitz-Pochinsky side, and vice versa. So you might be able to identify some of them as the massive vacua. But let me not go into that for now. And in the hadronic case, one can apply a similar construction in the linear sigma model. In that case, what's different is that there's no analog of massive vacua, and the linear sigma model simply suggests a smooth transition. So there's nothing very special happening when you tune the parameter across the point where the topology changes. One last point, let me say that one cannot exclude the possibility that the transition is actually smooth in the type 2 theory, but it's smooth only when we take into account the quantum corrections or the string loop corrections. Of course, a phase transition is also possible. But one point I should say is that in the end, if one is able to consider all the stringent corrections, like even non-perturbative ones, one should be able to find a smooth transition just based on simple physical principle, because both the black hole and the string are some system with finite degrees of freedom. So there cannot be a phase transition between the two. But it's not clear like what kinds of corrections we need to take into account to really find a smooth transition. So let me move on to the last part. How much time do I have? Okay, I only need maybe 15 minutes or 10 minutes.
Oh yeah, 15 minutes, including maybe more question.
Okay. Maybe then, are there any questions at this point? Okay, then I'll move on. So what I just said are all about neutral solutions, but it's very natural, of course, to wonder about charged toroids potential solution, how they are related to the charged black holes. So you might ask, okay, do we now need to do all the analysis from scratch again, like write down the action involves gauge fields and solving all the nonlinear equations, which sounds very complicated. But the actual answer is no, we don't really need to do that. So the idea is that we can start from just the neutral solution and use the so-called solution generating technique to generate charged solutions. So in the literature, people have used this kind of technique to generate charged black hole solutions from neutral solutions. And the essential idea is that you have originally a time circle and you have a finite energy on the time circle, but you can add an extra direction, y direction, and you can add a non-compact direction, which is just a line, and you can generate momentum in that direction by boosting the solution in that direction. So you apply some boosting procedure and that generates some momentum in that direction. You can compactify it and do a KK reduction, and that gives you a charged black hole solution in the original dimensions. And you can also generate winding charge by doing a T duality in that compact circle, that extra circle. So through this procedure, you can generate in general a solution that carries both fundamental string momentum charge and winding charge. So you can generate the so-called two charge solutions. One important thing is that something we argued in the paper is that this general procedure can be phrased in a somewhat abstract way, which makes it clear that it applies for general CFTs that has a translational symmetry in the time direction. So that will include both the Horowitz-Pochinsky solution and the black hole solutions. But this is kind of an empty statement. It only tells you that you can apply this procedure, but the concrete transformation which takes you from a neutral metric to a charged metric is something more complicated. And in general, we don't know the concrete form. Basically, the reason is that in the interior of the space-time, because there's a non-trivial curvature, you expect these formulas to receive alpha prime corrections inside the space-time. So there are some alpha prime corrections that have been worked out in the literature, but we only know very limited knowledge about them. But one nice observation is that for our purpose, which essentially we want to know the thermodynamics of the charged solution, and for example, how the solution looks like near infinity, we only need a asymptotic form of the transformation. That is the form of the transformation near the spatial infinity. And since all the curvature and all the fields, they decay very fast near infinity, the transformation at infinity is essentially the transformation for a flat space. And those transformations have been discussed extensively in the literature. One particular nice formalism that was it was discussed in this paper by Maharana and Shiwaz in 92, and we just used their formalism and apply them to both the Horowitz potential solution and the black hole solution. So let me tell you why we only need the form, the asymptotic form of the transformation. The reason is that the action, this is a very interesting statement in classical string theory, is that the action, on-shell action, is solely a boundary term. So all the bulk term of the action just vanish on-shell. And the boundary term is, in fact, specifically only the Gibbons-Hawking-York term. Okay, you must have heard about this in the context of computing the thermodynamics of a black hole, but in more generally, this is a statement that is true to arbitrary order in the alpha prime perturbation, in alpha prime perturbation. So the reason that you don't need to worry about higher curvature correction to the boundary term is that all the curvature decays very fast. So if you evaluate the higher curvature corrections at infinity, they are simply zero. And the only non-zero terms are the extrinsic curvature term, which also exists in the Einstein gravity, and an extra term, which is the normal derivative of the dilaton, which is something special in string theory. So you have this action, and that's it. That's the entire on-shell action. You can just evaluate that. And since this is something that is evaluated at infinity, to evaluate it, you only need to know the asymptotic form of the metric and the dilaton. So for example, here, I'm writing the metric like the GTT component of the metric. I expand it as one minus something that falls off very fast infinity. And I only need to know this particular parameter mu, which physically is the corresponds to the mass of whatever stuff that is inside your space-time. And one extra parameter that you need to know is this parameter C, which is the fall off of the dilaton. And actually a statement that we showed in our paper is that, in fact, you only need to know the mass as a function of the temperature, and then you can just simply solve for this value C. But that is some detail. Let me not go into that. The essential point is, here is that if you know the asymptotic form, you can just compute the action. Once you know the action, you can compute the thermodynamic quantities using the Gibbons-Hawking procedure. And so the point is that following all these statements, if you know the thermodynamics of the neutral solution and you apply the solution generating technique, you can work out all the thermodynamics of the charged solution. And those formulas are exact in alpha prime expansion. So they are valid for arbitrary solutions, for example, the Horowitz potential solution and the black hole solution. So in this picture, we start from some seed solution, which is a neutral solution, has zero charge. And essentially you can just from it, you can following a solution generating technique, you can generate a one parameter family. More generally it's a two parameter family because you have two charges. But in this picture, it's just a one parameter line, and you can work out all the thermodynamic quantities along the line, okay? So this gives us an update on the picture towards extremality, because I have already discussed some aspects of the transition from black hole to Horowitz potential solution to free string at zero charge, but under the solution generating technique, that gives you a picture of this transition at finite charge. So let's fix the charge and decrease the mass, which is usually what's called the extremal limit. And you see that as you approach the extremal limit, the black hole first goes into a Horowitz potential-like phase. And in this phase, there's no horizon anymore. And at some point, you also see that the quantum fluctuations around the charged Horowitz potential solution becomes large, and you expect a similar transition to free string, okay? So instead of having a black hole, just approach the extremal limit, you find it's more appropriate to think of this, this transition in several steps. Okay, So let me mention one interesting historical fact. So this black hole solution that carries two charges, it has been studied in the early literature when people are trying to relate black holes and strings. And this is like the simplest kind of black hole, so it's a natural black hole to look at. But the special property of this black hole is that the naive extremal limit is actually singular. So usually when we, for example, in Einstein gravity, when we look at the extremal limit of Reisner-Nordstrom black hole, the extremal limit is not singular. The horizon still has a finite size. But if you look at this kind of black hole in string theory, when you approach the extremal limit, the horizon actually shrinks to a point. So that tells you that if you look at the Bekenstein-Hawking entropy of the extremal black hole, you simply find zero. Of course, this is only true when you are working at the leading order in the alpha prime correction. And in the literature, like Dabhokar and Sen, they have considered various alpha prime corrections to the singular black hole solution. And after you consider those corrections, you find the solution becomes non-singular. It has some, it becomes a string scale object. And you can actually, they manage to mesh some property of those solutions with free string results, essentially the entropy of that solution. But here it seems we are seeing a different picture, because here we are saying that you are not supposed to be looking at the black hole solution anymore when you are close to extremality. Well, you are really supposed to look at is the Horowitz-Pochinsky solution. And a simple calculation tells you that the charged Horowitz-Pochinsky solution naturally produces properties you expect for a string carrying charges, for example, the size and entropy, et cetera. So we don't have a good understanding of why you can also get the correct answer by considering some alpha prime corrections. One very vague thing you might say is that that might be consistent with the fact that the two solutions are actually smoothly connected because they consider the solutions in heterotic string theory. So they might be consistent with what we are saying, but we don't really have a further understanding than that. Okay, so let me just comment on a side note. So here we are considering, we're talking very specifically about perhaps the simplest charged black hole solutions in string theory. That is black holes that carries fundamental string momentum and winding charge. There is a rich literature on the near extremal limit of other types of black holes. And in many cases, the near extremal limit of these black holes are very good. They are not singular. So we don't know, and there is a huge literature that is discussing basically the near extremal limit of other types of black holes that carry more charges. For example, the fastball community, they are trying to construct, for example, one thing they are trying to construct is the near extremal limit of three charged black holes. It will of course be interesting to understand whether there can be an analog of the Horowitz-Pochinsky solution also in other types of black holes, but we don't have a more concrete understanding at this point. Okay, let me summarize. So in this talk, we revisited the Horowitz-Pochinsky solution, which is a classical solution in just a classical string theory. It's a classical solution that is constructed in Euclidean signature, but it has many properties that suggests it has the right interpretation as a string star, that is a string gas, which is bound together by gravity in the Lorentzian signature. So this solution has the remarkable property that it has a classical entropy that you can compute just by using Euclidean path integral, but the entropy also has a clear Lorentzian interpretation that is absent for the black hole. So as we argued, this solution, it cannot be smoothly connected to the black hole as classical solutions in type two string theory, while the opposite is likely true, although we don't have a proof in the heterotic string theory. So you can generate charged solutions through the solution generating technique. And in the case of capital D equals to 4, we go into the Horowitz-Poschinsky solution when we approach the near extremal limit of this type of black hole. So that's all I want to say. Say thank you very much.
Thank you. Questions?
Can I ask a question about the previous part?
You mean the charge? So, which part?
So you numerically solved the Horowitz-Poschinsky solution, and it demands the normalization condition, which is the integral of chi hat square is 1, right? But I noted that in some previous literature, they didn't use this kind of condition. Instead, they used some condition like chi hat at origin is equal to 1. So my question is that, is there any difference between these two conditions?
Yeah, so I'm not sure which specific literature you were talking about.
Oh, for example, the literature named mini soliton star.
Yeah. This is just different ways to solve the equation. So there is no fundamental difference. The point is that this equation, like the equation showing here, it involves some parameters, but you can rescale both chi and the coordinate to put the equations into a form that only involve dimensionless functions and coordinates. And so you can choose different rescaling. One rescaling can be choose such that the integral of this rescaled function is 1. That is the first method you were talking about. You can, of course, choose a different rescaling such that this rescaled function at the origin is 1. That is the second method you were talking about. But this is just different ways of rescaling the equation. But if once you translate it into the original function, the answer will be the same. Like the physical field chi will be the same in the two, no matter which method you are using.
So the difference is only a technical.
Yeah, it's just a technical detail, how you rescale the solution.
Do you think the normalization condition is easier to solve? Because I think an initial condition like chi zero is equal to 1.
Yeah. In practice, I will use the second method you are talking about. Yeah, that's actually how you do it.
I see.
Okay.
Thank
Hello.
You.
Hello, may I ask a question?
Yes, please.
In your previous slide without the charge, it seems like the black hole occurs in the low temperature and if you go to the finite temperature, like a Huygens temperature, it seems Horowitz-Poschinsky solution. But in the charged case, it seems that in the high temperature, and it is a black hole. But in the low temperature, it seems HP solution. It seems reverse, right?
Yeah. So, that's partly right. So I guess you got that picture from thinking about the Reisner-Nordström black hole, for example, right? So when you approach the extremal limit, the temperature should get lower rather than higher.
So there
are two answers to your question. So one thing is that you need to distinguish the temperature of the charged solution and the temperature of the seed solution that you started with. So the temperature of this seed solution is different from the temperature here. So the temperature is not invariant under the solution generating technique. So as you said, when you go from this go from this black hole part to the Horowitz-Poschinsky part, the temperature increase, but that doesn't necessarily imply that when you go along this line, the temperature also increase. So that's the first point. The second point is that in four dimension, the string theory black hole, this two charged black hole actually is kind of funny. The temperature actually I think it gets higher when you approach the extremal limit. So it's different from the Reisner noise from black hole. But in higher dimensions, when the dimension is 5 and higher, it will be the same as Reisner noise from black hole, that the temperature gets lower when you approach this, when you approach extremality. In that case, it's simply the fact that the temperature here is not the same as the temperature of the C solution.
Okay, thanks. And another question, is this picture universal or does it need some parameter regime? In this picture, when you approach to the extremal limit, it goes to the HP solution. Is it a general case or does it hold some particular parameter?
Yeah, so essentially, in fact, you can only trust. So let me first talk about the seed solution, like the uncharged solution. For the black hole, you can only trust it here, like the mass is very large. For the Horace Pochinski solution, you can trust it here, but not close to this dashed line. And so you expect, so the argument that we have is that if we know a solution we trust, we can use it to generate a charged solution. So from that, we only trust like the charged solution like close to this point and when the mass is very large. But in the middle, we don't have a analytic control of the solution. Does that answer your question?
More questions? Questions from online or offline? So in the conclusion, you mentioned this is a classically smoothly connected, but when you justify it, you're actually counting the index.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. In the third conclusion, smoothly connected as a classic solutions. But you, when you justify this, you count in this index, which is a quantum property.
No. So here by So only at the classical level, the solution is described by a Walshi CFT. That's what classical means. That here classical means that we are working at the leading order in one over in the string coupling. But of course, even the Walshi CFT, it is a CFT, and the index is of course a quantum mechanical object in that CFT. So maybe let me give you an analog. So basically, like, let's just think about the string theory in flat space. At classical level, it's described by a bosonic field theory, by a bunch of free boson. That is a classical statement. Of course, there are a lot of quantum corrections in that space-time. Like you need to consider quantum fluctuation of various fields. And those are not just is not included in just a simple scalar field theory, of course. Those are more complicated stuff. So the analogy would be, at classical level, the string theory is described by a free scalar field theory, and you are computing the index in that quantum field theory. Does that make sense?
Okay, I got another question. It's, right. Okay. So when you can you go to this earlier action slice, you first constructed this effective. Okay, maybe this, sorry, next. This like a transition diagram figures. So can you explain this next one?
Next slide, this slide.
Next.
This side?
These two figures, one you have S1 or some SD minus one or SD minus one and S1. It seems there's an exchange of this.
This one?
Yes. Can you explain this, the below these two figures, how to understand these two?
Oh, you mean why the Horowitz potential solution has
right
by this picture?
Right.
So essentially you can think of, so the space always, if you fix the radial direction, you think about flat space. The topology of Horowitz potential solution is just flat space. So if you think of flat space as some fixed radius, the topology is a circle, which is the Euclidean time circle, times just a sphere at that radius, right? And since the topology of the Horowitz potential solution is just a flat space, the sphere can shrink to zero size, which is just you decrease the radial direction and the size of the transverse sphere shrinks to a point at the origin of your space-time. But at that point, the Euclidean circle is still finite. It still has a finite size. So this picture is just the topology of a flat space. The only difference from flat space is that the size of the circle is back-reacted a little bit. But the topology of a Euclidean black hole is completely different. Essentially, you also look at the sphere at finite radius, but you know that the Euclidean space-time terminates at the horizon, meaning that the transverse sphere has a minimal size, which is the Schwarzschild radius. And at that point, the Euclidean space terminates because the Euclidean time circle shrinks to a point. And in the Euclidean signature, you can't go any further. In the Lorentzian signature, it continues into the interior of a black hole. In the Euclidean case, it just terminates there. So the topology are different.
I see. So in the viewpoint of counting index, does it really matter? You know, and you demanding the temperature below the Hedron temperature. I mean, I'm just wondering if you go beyond that one, can you do some computation? Because essentially you compute the index.
Yeah, I don't think there's any story that is known for these theories beyond Hedron temperature, because the common law is that the space-time ceases to exist because you can excite arbitrary number of strings and the space-time description doesn't work anymore. So I'm not sure in that case you are supposed to think of this topology anymore. I simply physically, I think that is just doesn't make sense. In fact, you can even complain that thermal ensemble in flat space doesn't make sense at all, even when you are below Hedron temperature. The reason is that both the Horowitz potential solution and the black hole solution, they are unstable solution. Let's just think about the black hole in flat space. A very crucial property of the black hole in flat space is that it has negative specific heat. So you can consider this solution, but if you perturb it a little bit, it will swallow like the stuff outside the black hole. It will become infinitely large, or it will evaporate very fast and become infinitely small. So it doesn't make a lot of sense to talk about this in canonical ensemble. The better way to think about this is to use the canonical ensemble to construct the solution, but interpret them as a solution in the microcanonical ensemble, where you fix the mass rather than the temperature. So that makes more sense. But yeah, I don't think it makes sense to think about the solutions beyond Hedron temperature. But maybe that's because we don't know the non-perturbative effects in string theory good enough.
Okay. Any more questions?
From the numerical solution of Horowitz-Poznanski, it looks like the derivative of chi at zero is zero. Is that true?
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, it's because it should be zero because it's a spherical symmetric solution, right? So it doesn't really depend on which direction you are looking at.
So if it is not zero, there should be a delta function like voltage at origin, right?
Yeah. Then the origin will be, there is some singularity there. This solution is just smooth. There's nothing special at the origin.
I see. Thank you.
Can I ask a question?
Yes, please.
I want to understand the size of bro, what means?
In your previous plot, you have a plot about this a black hole string transition connected by this Horowitz and Poznanski, and there are two blobs. There are two blobs, and there are this yellow blob and the purple blob. Mm-hmm. And he was wondering what is the meaning of the size of the blob. Is there a kind of a meaning of the size?
No, this is just this picture is completely schematic. You see that it's not even in log scale or what. It's just
Okay. So
size of the blob doesn't matter. What matters is that we don't. It is supposed to represent a region that we don't have theoretical control. Like,
Okay.
We don't know how to construct the solution in the middle.
Oh.
For example, for the black hole, we know the black hole solution when mass is very large, essentially just the black hole that we see in the sky. But when the black hole gets smaller, its curvature becomes larger. And when curvature gets larger in string theory, there are many effects like alpha prime corrections, stringent corrections to the black hole, and we don't have a clear understanding of the black hole in those regions.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
No problem.
Okay, if no more questions, let's thank Yimin again for the great talk.
Okay.
Hi, thank you. Thank you so much. It must be very late.
It's fine. It's 10:30. Yeah, but I need to get up early tomorrow because I need to catch a flight.
Yeah. Yes. Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
老师，你可以直接结束会议。
啊，对 ，You're right. 你是现在是主持人。OK。撤了。
走了。那么，
朱经纬今天也来了。
嗯。
对，我最近也在研究这个 paper， 就像我们最近就是在做这个。
啊 ，Good。
然后我也有在重复他的那个数值结果。
OK。The David must be very interesting.
对。
Okay.好了，如果没有讨论的话，我们就结束了。
好，再见。
好，再见。